From an early age, Lloyd Avery II wanted to be a musician, but a career in films soon became his burning passion. After starring in John Singleton's movie, Avery's career took somewhat of a downward spiral, and few knew that his private life was slowly becoming eerily similar to that of the on-screen character that kick-started his career. His transition from Hollywood actor to an inmate at Pelican Bay State Prison is the tragic tale of one man reaching the precipice of fame, only to bring about his own demise. Ladies and gentlemen, Queen Amadi TV presents The Rise and Fall, The Life and Death of the Actor Lloyd Avery II on this episode of True Crime. Lloyd Fernandez Avery II was born on June the 21st of 1969. He grew up in a working-class neighborhood next to Baldwin Hills, also known as the Black Beverly Hills in L.A. Along with his father, Lloyd Sr., his mother, Linda, and his siblings, they were a quiet middle-class family. Their father was a man of many skills, a qualified plumber, electrician, and an expert carpenter who operated his own business, while his wife was a stay-at-home mom until the late 1980s when she worked in banking. Avery had a comfortable childhood. His brother Che would later recall that they were silver spoon kids who never wanted for anything. Unlike some of their friends, the family of six had a pool in their backyard at View Park. Raised in a Christian household, their parents instilled in the boys and their sister the value of a good education, and they were enrolled into school integration programs, with Lloyd attending Beverly Hills High School. There he excelled in baseball and water polo. Avery was often seen driving his brown Pinto doing donuts near the swim gym. He was considered the class clown, usually telling jokes to his classmates. Although he had a shy nature at times, he was known as a fun person to be around. And although he didn't date much, the girls in his lectures were enamored with his pretty boy looks and his long eyelashes. Some of his closest friends were the children of some of the most well-known celebrities in the music business, such as musician and songwriters Quincy Jones, Smokey Robinson, and Clarence Avant. He developed quite a relationship with Quincy Jones III. Avery and his fellow students would often attend house parties on the weekends, meeting up at mansions while the parents were on vacation. But he didn't drink or do drugs. Instead, he liked to play a game called Party and Pouch, in which people would, as actor and friend Doran Reed refers to it, steal things at parties just to steal them. But at this point in his life, Avery was no budding criminal. He was more of an attention seeker, a troublemaker with a high-pitched laugh, who wasn't interested in gang culture. He had a knack for exposing insecurities, pushing buttons, and developed something of a sarcastic streak, which sometimes provoked a reaction. Sometimes things even got violent. Avery's friend Brent Rollins, the art director and graphic designer who created the logo for Boys in the Hood, recalls how one time comedian Robin Harris attacked Avery at a Jet magazine photo shoot just minutes after meeting him. Rollins says, "I don't know what Lloyd said to him. All I remember is Harris was choking him against a sofa. He had a mischievous streak and a really sweet streak," Rollins says. He says the day before Christmas Eve, he would drive around to people's houses to give them Christmas cards. Who does that? But Avery's incessant needling was just one negative aspect of his larger personality. He was also impulsive and reckless, something which led to his first incarceration. During one night in 1988, Avery and several friends, including Doran Reed, were leaving a UCLA party in Westwood when they were approached by a group of frat brothers. Avery cracked a joke, then some words were exchanged between the groups, and soon a fight broke out. Then just as a patrol car appeared down the street, three gunshots rang out. Although Avery wasn't the one who fired the weapon, he was carrying a fake ID, and as a result, he spent 3 days in jail. His friends were concerned afterward, not because of the circumstances of what happened, but because Avery had a strange reaction to it. They said that he seemed to have enjoyed being in jail. One of his friends, Keith Davis, said, "What scared me was that Lloyd was laughing about it. He told me that he really liked jail. It's like, how the hell do you get locked up and you just enjoy it? He was so flippant." But this wouldn't be Avery's last arrest. After dropping out of Los Angeles Trade Technical College, he worked alongside his father, but didn't want to follow in his footsteps, despite being a gifted handyman. Avery had a passion, and it was music, but his father disapproved. He wanted Avery to follow in his footsteps and become a plumber, an electrician, or a carpenter. They began to have disputes over this, and one day during an argument, his father took a baseball bat and began destroying his music equipment so that he'd no longer be able to work on his music. His mother, Linda, recalls that he wasn't happy at all with the choices Lloyd made. But what his father wanted for Lloyd wasn't for Lloyd, she says. It seemed Avery had learned a valuable lesson from the incident, but it was not the one his father had intended. In June of 1990, he was again arrested, this time for stealing studio equipment from a guitar center. It was around the same time that Avery would get his big break, albeit unexpected. A friend, John Singleton, was making his first feature film. As Avery would later explain during his murder trial, "I met the right person at the right time, and they put me in a movie." An Inglewood native, Singleton had excelled at the filmic writing program at USC and was a two-time winner of the Jack Nicholson Screenwriting Award. Singleton had an aspiration to make movies, and with his undeniable raw talent, he had the drive to succeed. Shortly after graduation, Columbia Pictures agreed to film Singleton's script for Boys in the Hood, with him as the director. The cast was made up of Avery, most locals from which Singleton intended to keep a sense of realism to his project. It depicted gang culture and the lives of three African-American boys growing up in South Central Los Angeles. The film followed the friendship between Cuba Gooding Jr.'s character, Trey Styles, and the Baker brothers played by Ice Cube and Morris Chestnut. In one of the film's most memorable scenes, Chestnut's character, Ricky Baker, a promising football star, and Gooding's character, they go to a store to pick up groceries. There they spot a group of blood-affiliated gang members led by Ferris, one of whom was played by Avery, and the two split up to avoid any trouble. Avery was required to be on set to show support, even if he appeared on the day's call sheet or not. His co-stars remember him as friendly and humble, and he apparently took direction well from his friend Singleton, who meticulously prepared Avery for his big scene, which just so happened to be the most iconic scene of the entire movie. Singleton instructed Avery at every turn, from how to point the gun to how to generate a simultaneously cold-hearted and menacing stare. No detail was considered too small. He wanted this scene to be just right. But that day's shooting did not get off to an encouraging start. You see, the scene involved Cuba Gooding Jr., whose character was about to witness his best friend's murder. And at this stage in his career, Cuba Gooding Jr. was a method actor, so he spent the entire morning in his trailer brooding. Just before shooting started, Avery greeted him, and Gooding snapped. "Don't effing talk to me right now," he said. A production assistant stepped in to defuse the situation. Now, despite this discord on set, the finished scene is one of the most emotional in the entire film, a resulting masterclass in building tension that culminated in Avery's scene-stealing appearance as Knucklehead Number 2. Malcolm Norrington, a college friend of Singleton's who played Knucklehead Number 1, said that shot of him out the window holding the gun is iconic. John was so happy when he got that shot. Despite Avery's character having only appeared in several small scenes, this made him a celebrity around the neighborhoods of Los Angeles because of his notorious role in the film as a member of the Crenshaw Mafia. At 6'1", Avery was easily recognizable and found himself ushered past the queues outside nightclubs. Initially, he enjoyed his newfound fame and intended on fully exploiting it. He hired an agent and went on numerous auditions, and his future in the movie industry seemed unstoppable. With his African-American and Mexican descent and handsome good looks, it was believed the young Avery would go far, possibly even landing leading roles one day. During this time, his music career began to take off as he produced Push, the lead single on actress Tisha Campbell's debut album, Tisha. His acting career continued. This time, he was cast in Singleton's follow-up, Poetic Justice, in 1993, alongside his Boys in the Hood co-star, Dedrick D. Gobert. This new role of Thug One would hardly be considered a step up from his previous character of Knucklehead Number Two. But Singleton had planned to nurture Avery, who was, after all, an untrained actor. He starred alongside his brother Che, who played Thug Two, as well as Janet Jackson, Regina King, and the late Tupac Shakur. Avery's cameo, where he once again played a killer, was the strongest thread connecting the movie Poetic Justice to Boys in the Hood. It's quite a different film from Singleton's debut, of being both a road trip and a love story. It was quieter and slower than Boys in the Hood. Now, the film proved a disappointment with critics and underperformed at the box office. Poetic Justice would also be a disappointment to Avery as well. In his brash style, he let Singleton and everyone else at the film's premiere know exactly what he thought of it. As the closing credits rolled, Avery stood up and shouted, "That shit was whack, John." The incident didn't prove to be the end of Avery's friendship with Singleton, but it was just the latest instance of Lloyd being Lloyd, as the actor's inappropriate outburst were termed. Around this time, Avery was staying with Quincy Jones III, the producer and filmmaker known as QD III, who resided in the jungle, where Avery had become a legend because of his role as the killer in Boys in the Hood. He probably got a pass for the fact that he killed someone as a blood on film. This is what Baldwin C. Sykes says, a Compton native who played Monster in Boys in the Hood. He says that he also received similar praise because of his character on film. Sykes says, "Up to this day, I have people say, 'Monster, you shot the blood. You represent it. You should be down with my hood.' And I'm like, 'I'm not down with the hood. That was an acting role.'" But Avery thought differently. He considered Knucklehead Number Two as his claim to fame, a role that defined him. It would be a moment he would relive off screen. Not long after the release of Boys in the Hood, Avery shocked those closest to him by moving away from his middle-class neighborhood and relocating to an area known as the Jungle, the heavily blood-affiliated neighborhoods of Crenshaw Boulevard, Coliseum Street, Santo Tomas Drive, and La Brea Avenue. Lloyd seemed to embrace the culture of his new home. Malcolm Norrington, who played Knucklehead Number One in Boys in the Hood, recalled his co-star during filming, saying that he was kind of meek. He wasn't anything near a street guy. Within a year of Boys in the Hood, I was hearing about him missing auditions. I don't remember when I heard about him joining a gang. I just remember being perplexed. To me, it was like, what's he doing? Blooding? Lloyd? His friend Keith Davis remembers the first time Avery revealed his blood affiliation. He says, "We were shopping at the Slauson swap meet. Some rolling 60s came up and were like, 'You're the guy from Boys in the Hood?' 'Yeah, that was me.' 'You shot Ricky, right?' 'Yeah, that was me.' 'Hey, cuz, you really a blood?' 'Yeah, what's up, blood?' I was looking at him like, 'What?' Lloyd just kind of laughed. They asked him if he was a blood, and it clicked. 'Yeah, I'm a blood now.'" Avery's association with the Bloods gang make little sense considering he grew up near Crip territory. He also knew the dangers of gangbanging because the streets had already claimed the life of his younger brother. His other brother, too, would soon take the wrong path in life, but on the opposite side of what Avery would choose. Che Avery was admitted to UC Berkeley and UCLA after gaining a 3.6 GPA at Beverly Hills High, but he decided he wouldn't attend either school. He stated in a 1992 Los Angeles Times article that he just felt some kind of attraction to the streets. Unlike his brother, Che didn't hang with the rich kids at Beverly Hills High, though he claims to have partied with a Menendez brother on prom night. He dressed in Eazy-E cosplay, and although he wasn't gangbanging at the time, he felt there was a certain image that he had to live up to. Gang affiliation among R&B stars is something that was and still is prevalent. However, very few actors have become embroiled in the gang warfare of the streets. But in November of 1994, Avery's Boys in the Hood and Poetic Justice co-star, Dedrick D. Gobert, became involved in a gang-related fight during which he was shot dead along with a friend after attending an illegal street race. The actor was killed just days before his 23rd birthday. Surprisingly, Lloyd Avery II had the same respect that an OG earns, although he earned his due to a murder that he committed on film. However, he was determined to earn his stripes the old-fashioned way. He put in work, and the Bloods showered him with the attention that he craved. He often wore red with Chuck Taylors and khakis and became just as notorious as his on-screen character in Boys in the Hood. His brother Chase says that he once came across someone with Avery's face tattooed on his forearm. Avery himself got the word Jungles tattooed over his left eye. His transition was now complete. You see, he was no longer the actor who played the Blood who shot Ricky, but he had become the Blood who shot Ricky. His anger and frustration had festered into criminal activity, stemmed from the fact that he was desperately wanting to be a star, but was coming to terms with the realization that it wasn't going the way he wanted. Casting opportunities like Boys in the Hood had come so easily that Avery thought every role would be just as simple. He rarely prepared for his auditions, if he even bothered showing up at all. Doran Reed says, "I auditioned with him once, and if that's how he's going to audition, he wasn't going to get anything." Avery's music career had also stalled, despite his numerous and influential industry connections. But despite appearing in a blockbuster like Boys in the Hood, which was actually nominated for an Oscar, Avery's behavior took a toll, and he wouldn't appear in another film until 3 years later. That gig was an uncredited role in the Wayans Brothers' 1996 crime comedy film, Don't Be a Menace to South Central While Drinking Your Juice in the Hood, a film that was a parody of movies from the 90s like Boys in the Hood, Menace to Society, Poetic Justice, and others. In that small role, Avery played Guy in the Back Seat. And this would be his last acting role for the next 4 years. With his career falling apart, Avery still somehow managed to excel in ruining friendships. Singleton retained a fondness for Avery, finding his practical jokes endearing. But Avery continued to push the envelope and antagonize him, even after the stunt he pulled at the Poetic Justice premiere. Norrington says, "He called John names at times. It got to the point where John stopped taking Lloyd's calls. As his friends grew up and moved on, Lloyd became increasingly isolated." With his acting work all but dried up, he cashed small residual checks and washed cars for $5 at a time. LA police also suspected that he was selling crack. He emerged back on the scene in February of 1999. Starring in an uncredited role as Man in Jail in Eric Meza's comedy film, The Breaks. Not long after leaving his longtime apartment, he decided to share a Hollywood crash pad with four surfer brothers that he had just met. This arrangement ended when he maced his roommate's mother. Avery was out of control, and one time at a nightclub, he also maced former MTV VJ Downtown Julie Brown. His life was in a free fall. He would steal a bike or car to get to work, and he was said to have packed a gun to a casting call. A witness saw him wielding a gun during an argument on the Venice Beach boardwalk. He seemed violent one minute, then weepy and apologetic the next. He also started going to church, but would rarely make it inside the doors. His Aunt Carol Avery says she remembers that he would get dressed, go, be there, but would leave prior to the lesson and walk around the grounds. She says, "I figured he was struggling and Satan was pulling at him to keep him from hearing the lesson." Prior to Avery going on a downward spiral, he had been radiating with intensity. His charisma had elevated this nameless henchman into an iconic villain. Veteran casting director Robbie Reed, known for her work with Spike Lee and other Black filmmakers, said that Lloyd had a presence that she thought was undeniable, saying that when people refer to that it factor, it's really intangible. You just know it when you see it. Despite Avery's breakthrough occurring in one of the most important films of the 1990s, he was unable to keep up the momentum because of all the troubles that he had. He just couldn't seem to shake his demons. They appeared to be in full control. By 1999, Avery was so embroiled in gang culture and violence, he became involved in a real-life gang-related incident when he participated in the murders of two people. Although he no longer lived in the jungle, he still hung out with residents there. And on July the 1st of 1999, at around 4 p.m., Avery approached Annette Lewis and Percy Branch, who were sitting under a tree near Santa Barbara Plaza. According to police reports, after a brief argument, allegedly over a drug debt, Avery pulled out a .45 caliber pistol. He fired his weapon at Lewis before turning it on Branch, who was then shot in the stomach. Lewis died later that day, while Branch passed away 3 weeks later due to complications from his wounds. Boys in the Hood earned John Singleton, its 23-year-old writer and director, Academy Award nominations for Best Director and Best Original Screenplay. It also made $57 million at the domestic box office against a $6 million budget, and it catapulted the film careers of Singleton, Angela Bassett, Ice Cube, Morris Chestnut, Nia Long, and future Academy Award winners Cuba Gooding Jr. and Regina King. Perhaps Lloyd Avery would have made it to that level of success had he not been plagued by so many things that kept him wanting to live a street life and to be a thug and to live the gang culture that he portrayed in films. Avery was couch surfing with friends and family when the wanted posters went up in the fall of 1999. Now a struggling actor and rapper, he seemed personally and professionally lost since his debut in Boys in the Hood. His brother Chase says, "People I ran into were always like, what's going on with Lloyd? It seems like he's self-destructing." Surprisingly, Avery didn't go into hiding after the murders. He instead went on to film two movies while the wanted posters were still up. He'd been staying at his grandmother's house when he received some unexpected good news from his agent at Privileged Talent and Models. He found that he'd been booked for a movie role in New Mexico. 13 days after the murders of Lewis and Branch, Avery was on set filming the movie Lockdown, which started on July the 14th of 1999 in cell block 4 of the penitentiary in New Mexico. This location was the scene of one of the deadliest prison riots in U.S. history. It was known as the Old Main, and the section of the prison was closed down in 1998. But there were still relics of the violence, such as the axe marks from where snitches were decapitated. The atmosphere on set was tense. When filming wrapped for the day, the crew would often unwind at a local bar. Avery refused to mix with the crew, preferring to remain in his hotel room. On the one rare occasion he attended, he ended up fighting with one of the lead actors, DeAndre Bonds. The scuffle was broken up by a tattoo artist on the set, which then led to Avery feuding with the hair and makeup department. Makeup department head Melanie Mills says, "He said he was going to find me and my family when we got back to LA and that he was going to murder us." Avery had already made himself a pariah on set, having scrapped with Gabrielle Casillas following their fight scene, throwing a tantrum after filming the scene during which his character Nate was thrown into the freezer. But possibly his biggest mistake was continuously antagonizing Percy Miller, known as Master P, one of the stars and producers of the film. P's guys would come to me and say, "Do you want us to F him up?" This is what director John Lausenhoff, who would then tell them, "No, please, leave him alone." As a result, the producers cut some of Avery's scenes and he was soon to be thrown off set. On the day Lloyd Avery II was fired from the set of Lockdown, he was spotted by crew smoking a Sherm stick on the back of a grip truck during his lunch break while blasting music from a stolen boombox. When he was asked to return the radio, Avery stormed into the makeup room and lunged towards Melanie Mills. Before he could reach her, he was intercepted by the tattoo artist, who punched him in the face, splattering blood everywhere. Avery was then chased off the set by Master P's entourage and run toward the new prison facility down the road. Dressed in full wardrobe as a prisoner, Avery scaled a tall barbed wire fence. At that moment, sirens began blaring and guns were drawn. Avery had unwittingly infiltrated a working prison. The film's line producer, Eric Abramson, a former Navy SEAL demolition expert, had to plead with guards and expert snipers to stand down. Once subdued, Avery was ordered to leave the state of New Mexico. Despite the humiliation of getting fired from lockdown and practically being escorted out of the state, Avery felt optimistic about his acting career upon returning to LA. He started attending auditions and even wrote a movie script titled G in a Bottle. Christine Chapman, his agent at Privileged Talent and Models, the Beverly Hills firm that represented him, described it as like Kazam, the movie where Shaq played a genie. She said, "This kid finds a bottle and out comes this ex-gang member who's changed his ways. It was actually kind of good." Avery befriended and eventually moved in with Chapman's son, an aspiring model named Sean Spraker. After a night of partying, Avery crashed at the studio apartment of Spraker's childhood friend, Jeremy McLaughlin. For the next 3 months or so, they couldn't get him to leave. Spraker says, "We couldn't really do much about it. No one wanted to confront him." Then things appeared to brighten up, albeit momentarily. Avery landed what is to be his most influential role to date, as the gangster G-Ride in the 2001 independent low-budget indie film, Shot, which documented life on the dangerous streets of South Central LA. This time, he was playing the lead character. Roger Roth, the film's writer and director, said he was impressed by Avery's audition, who had underplayed his emotions during the scene, he read. Roth had found the actor who would be his G-Ride. In the movie, G-Ride allows a white photographer named Robert, played by Brandon Carrer, essentially a stand-in for Roth, to ride with his gang and document life in the hood. Avery would be the ideal method actor for the role. He asked Roth to address him as G-Ride and kept his prop gun tucked in his waistband. This role came naturally to Avery, and it showed in his performance. "He was one of the best actors I ever worked with," Roth says. "He could nail every line. He could make you believe it. He could make you feel it." For the first time since he starred in Boys in the Hood, Avery became completely invested in a project. He demanded the final product be real and authentic and would protest when a line of dialogue or a costume felt anything less than the real McCoy. In an effort to pander to him, Roth went along with his decision. Avery would also serve as a technical advisor on the film, working with director Roger Roth and perhaps offering up his own experience of gang-related life in the jungle. To get it right, he pestered Avery with questions about the hood and even his own past. "I asked him if he was ever involved in killing. He just gave a smirk," says Roth. "I even thought it was kind of cool. It didn't register, the heaviness of having to kill someone." But before long, the relationship between star and director came to mirror that of G-Ride and Roberts. Avery started to bully and intimidate Roth, and on several occasions, he even promised to kill him. As for how he planned to kill him, Roth says, "I didn't repeat the threat. I didn't even tell the people closest to me. This way, I know it died with him." Reflecting on the time he spent with Avery, Roth has few words to say. He remembers sitting in his car, crying, paralyzed with fear, or the nights he spent sleeping in his secret editing suite. "Every hair on my arm is standing and my entire face is numb," he says. "I feel like he's here right now. I've never felt that way before. I believe in the afterlife, so that's possible. When I think back on Lloyd, I think it's one of the greatest missed opportunities. Had he been able to control himself and not commit double murder, there's no doubt he would have been a big success. But Lloyd Avery had much on his mind, and the past was catching up with this actor turned acting gangster who all that time had been harboring his dark secret. Che remembers the last night he spent with his brother as a free man. The two were sitting in the two-car garage of their grandmother's house on Crescent Heights Boulevard near Beverly Hills. As they sat and talked and smoked hits from a bong, Che recalled his brother saying, "I've had a good life." And as they continue to smoke, he says, "You want to hear something scary?" But Che knew that Los Angeles detectives had been searching for his brother to speak with him. It seemed like he wanted to get something off of his chest, but Che was worried about what he might say. "I don't want to hear that mess," Che muttered, and pulled out a pocket knife, brandishing it in the air, indicating that he wanted to cut the conversation short. Nothing more was said that evening, and Lloyd spent the night sleeping on the floor in his grandmother's bedroom. The LAPD were aware of exactly where Avery was hiding out, and the next morning, they moved to make an arrest. Che says he remembered the helicopters that morning were louder than usual, and there was lots of traffic outside of his grandmother's house. Avery was in the kitchen with his bike, and before he left out the back door, he gave his brother one last hug, but nothing more was said about the previous night. Avery made his way up Crescent Heights Boulevard, making a U-turn where he pulled alongside the driver's side door of a police cruiser. He then brazenly leaned forward and asked the officer, "What's up?" as he released his grip on the handlebars of his aluminum mongoose. Just then, the officer opened his door and Avery stumbled momentarily before recovering quickly, speeding west in an attempt to elude the pursuing police vehicle. He soon collided with another police car and was placed under arrest for the double homicide. Jay Avery says, "Instead of just being a Hollywood-like studio gangster, he wasn't having it. My brother turned into a for-real gangster." It appeared Lloyd Avery II never got over playing Knucklehead Number 2, and it really was a case of art imitating life, with him living the same type of lifestyle as his gun-wielding character in Singleton's film. The date of Avery's arrest was December the 8th, 1999. He had been apprehended following a tip from Sean Spraker. The roommates had previously had a falling out after Avery maced Spraker's mom, Christine Chapman, his own agent, during an argument at the privileged offices. Avery considered his arrest to be fate. By that time in his life, he had lost his way, and he knew that prison offered him a chance to turn his life around, as it once did for his brother, Che. While Avery was awaiting trial, he was incarcerated at the North County Correctional Facility, and there he found God and salvation in Chaplain Dennis Clark's congregation. Clark, the senior chaplain at the county jail, says he first noticed Avery sitting in the front row during Bible study. Soon he was speaking often with Clark in the prison chaplain office about what he was reading in the Bible. Clark says that whenever Avery committed himself to something, he went all in, and religion was no different. He says his faith was as real as any man's faith I've ever known. Now, after 2 years in jail, he went to trial in December of 2000. During each morning in court, Avery carried his Bible with highlighted passages and scribbles that he'd made in the margin. From the start of the prosecution's opening statement, it appeared that a different Lloyd Avery II was being judged, not the devout Christian that emerged in jail, whom the other inmates had nicknamed Baby Jesus. There were numerous issues when Lloyd Avery went to trial because, first and foremost, they allowed him to take the stand. His defense attorneys allowed him to take the stand in his own defense, which is very unusual for someone facing double homicide. Even if you're just facing one count of murder, that's very unusual. They usually don't want their clients to get up there and speak on their own behalf because they don't want them to get caught in any lies or just get caught off guard or not have the right answers for certain questions. But they allowed him to get up there, and he basically said that he didn't do it. He had an alibi. Well, his alibi was him saying that he was in Hollywood. He didn't say where he was. He didn't give any specifics. He didn't say what time he was there. He didn't say who was with him or any of those things. There was no way to corroborate his story, basically. But other problems were the fact that one of the witnesses requested money in exchange for their testimony. Also, a witness said that the perpetrator was dark-skinned and 5'7". Avery was 6'1", and he was not dark-skinned. Okay, also, there were some shell casings recovered from the scene, and those conveniently came up missing. Well, they say that the police mistakenly destroyed them. That's very important because they could have used that to do ballistics testing because they had shell casings from two other shootings that they claim Avery was in fact involved in. And so the evidence was destroyed. Nevertheless, with all of these problems and issues during the trial, Lloyd Avery II was still found guilty and convicted of double homicide and sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Avery arrived at Pelican Bay State Prison in March of 2001. During his time there, he kept out of trouble and was mostly preoccupied with spreading God's word to his fellow inmates, something that would ultimately lead to his demise. In August of 2005, Avery was paired up in a double cell with another inmate. This cellmate was Kevin Roby, an Air Force Academy dropout and paranoid schizophrenic, serving a life sentence for the horrific assault and murder of his own sister in January of 1987. During his time in prison, Roby had found a different faith than Avery's, and that was Satanism. He called himself the Satanic Christ. Now, the devout Avery believed that divine providence had offered him an opportunity in this living arrangement. He said, "I know God has him around me for a reason." This is what he told Chaplain Clark in a letter dated August the 29th of 2005. He said, "He knows very well that I am a devout Christian, and I pray for him to the Lord every day that he gives his life to God." Well, of course, Roby, being a devout Satanist, didn't like that and didn't want to feel that Avery was trying to enforce his beliefs on him. And so this all turned out very deadly for Avery. But the interesting thing about this whole scenario is the fact that Kevin Roby was in prison for 17 years by himself. He never had a cellmate. And then when Avery comes, they pair him up, a man who is a devout Christian, who's turned his life around, who has been nicknamed Baby Jesus. They put him in a cell with someone who is very dangerous and someone who calls himself the Satanic Christ. I think that this was all done by design, that they absolutely knew this was not going to work out well for Avery, and that it was all done on purpose. At the end of the day, Kevin Roby took Avery's life, and the only accounts that we have to go on as to what exactly happened are those of Kevin Roby's.
He was pushing the agenda of good and Jesus and all that, and he was a gangbanger. He was in prison for murder. And Lloyd Avery was forced into your cell by satanic power. So after that, what occurred?
Okay, he was pushing his agenda to convert me to Christianity, which led to us fighting. Then once he was defeated, that's when I put him on the pentagram to do a ritual, because in his defeat was also a certain amount of energy developed, and therefore and then he blood just started gushing out of him, right? So I used the blood to wash down the walls to trap his spirit within his cell so it couldn't leave, so I could do the ritual. And then once the ritual was done, this ritual was to send a message to God that, you know, this conflict, it was more so to send a message that he's next in the agenda. You know, once I'm completed with the things that I'm supposed to accomplish in this realm of existence, am I to go and confront him and present the true battle between the forces of light and darkness?
Right. So,
What was the pentagram? Was the pentagram, you know, was it painted in blood? Did you draw it on there?
No, the pentagram was drawn into the floor. It was waxed. It was with a Batman symbol in it, right? And on one of the big searches that they do in the prison, the guards came in destroy the pentagram that was on the floor. And they took their nightsticks and they banged out the eyes of the goat that was in the pentagram, and they spray painted it red, you know, like graffiti painted it red. But it was so waxed into the floor that I just removed the wax, and then I put blood in the eyes and then waxed it back over. So it had this weird look. And so the guards didn't want to go back in the cell no more because they're like, wow, the pentagram looks more evil than when they had originally went in. So they felt that, the symbol was now after them, so they wouldn't come back in the cell. But then when they forced him in there, right, and that's why I don't understand, if you're really pushing this, being this Christian that he was, why did you enter the cell when you had to cross over this pentagram? Because it was in the front of the cell, right? So he had to cross over the pentagram to enter the cell. But ultimately, he ended up on the pentagram. And I was doing it.
The interesting thing about Roby's explanation and description of his brutal murder that he committed upon Avery is the fact that he says Avery was supposed to be all into Christianity, but yet he entered the cell seeing the pentagram. He had to cross over. Well, I'm sure Avery didn't have a choice. When you're in prison, you don't get to choose your cellmate, nor do you get to choose which cell that you're housed in. So that makes no sense. It seems to me he was pretty much just gaslighting at that point. But notice how he said that he wanted to trap his spirit inside the cell and that he was trying to harvest this energy. This man was clearly sick. He said the same thing as to the reason and explanation for why he sexually assaulted and murdered his sister. He said that he was trying to create some type of a sexual energy or sex magic or whatever that he needed for a ritual. And so this man was very sick. They say that he was schizophrenic, but I, in fact, believe that he was demonically possessed. According to prison officials, correctional officers handcuffed Roby and then transferred Avery's body to the infirmary where they administered CPR, even though he was already decomposing. He was pronounced deceased at 12:10 p.m. Well, I don't believe that because it makes no sense. Why on earth would they perform CPR on a decomposing corpse? I think they said that just to feign concern for Avery's life and because they knew that there was more to the story than what they were going to tell. Back in Los Angeles, Linda Avery picked up her grandson from school when she received a letter in the mail from Avery. It would be minutes later when the prison called. From the start, the family doubted the official account. Che Avery flew straight to Pelican Bay that evening. He became immediately suspicious upon viewing his brother's body, saying that it smelled like old death. The family conducted a private autopsy, which slightly contradicted some of the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation's findings. The prison's autopsy report stated that Avery died from aspiration of blood and that blunt force trauma was the contributing factor. However, the family's autopsy stated that the cause of death was blunt force trauma, complicated by aspiration of blood. It also described the injury to Avery's skull, which was a 1.5-inch abrasion on his temple, as suggestive of either a blow to a flat surface, such as a carpenter's hammer, or impact on a similar type surface. The family's autopsy sounds more probable to me because blunt force trauma can absolutely cause aspiration of blood. It can even make someone cough up blood, whereas aspiration of blood with blunt force trauma as a contributing factor sounds less likely. Also, they didn't mention anything about Avery having defensive wounds as if he, you know, fought back or anything about Roby having any injuries. So I think that Roby likely caught Avery off guard. He may have snuck up on him from behind and hit him with something, or he may have gotten him while he was asleep, because he did say that after he killed Avery, he put him in the bed with sheets all over him. He likely killed him while he was in the bed. That's just my opinion. The reference to a carpenter's hammer led the family to believe that maybe Roby didn't act alone, but the blunt force trauma from the sort of weapon is in line, according to prison officials, with Roby banging Avery's head on the stainless steel sink in their cell. There's no evidence, they say, that correctional officers were involved with Avery's death. Believing that a trial would bring new information to light, the family urged local authorities to file charges against Roby. But the Del Norte County District Attorney refused, citing the fact that Roby was a confessed murderer and was not eligible for the death penalty. The State Attorney General's office declined to supersede the local DA. A wrongful death lawsuit was also considered until the NAACP and Johnny Cochran's law firm passed on representing the Avery family. Meanwhile, the prison started two investigations under the supervision of the California Inspector General Office's Bureau of Independent Review, one into Avery's death and the other on the conduct of the correctional officers. Released in early 2007, the report found that the correctional officers failed to follow basic procedures such as removing Avery's body before photographing the crime scene, and of course, for failing to notice that he was dead in his cell for 38 hours. Following an appeal, five officers received disciplinary actions ranging from a 5% pay cut for 45 days to a 10% pay cut for 6 months. When informed of the officer's punishments, Linda Avery simply replied, "So they just got a little tap on the hand." Crazy. The correctional officer who discovered Avery's body refused to comment. When he was contacted in November of 2020, he said, "I have nothing to say about it, man. I'm retired. It's no longer a part of my life." Another correctional officer who had knowledge of the incident and who also wanted to remain anonymous said, "These miscounts are not uncommon. These prisoners are assholes. These aren't nice people. So you're trying to get your count done, and there's one person who refuses to stand. Are you going to count him? We like a quiet day. We cherish a quiet day. I know all these officers in the case. They didn't do this on purpose. Was it lazy? Sure. Do they have absolute regret? Yes. To me, if there's any mystery here, it's why was Roby taken from single cell status to being in a double? Who cleared it? Prison officials don't clear it. That's management." That same year, in 2007, Pelican Bay administration officials declined to answer questions concerning the matter, citing third-party confidentiality and other individual privacy concerns. Kevin Roby received another life sentence and remains at Pelican Bay Prison, where he continues to sign his letters, "Satanic Christ," believing himself, in his own words, to be the prophesied killer of God and the rightful ruler of this universe. In letters, he has described how it was necessary to perform two rituals over the body of Lord Avery II in order to fulfill some sick satanic prophecy. He claims he is not a devil worshiper, but insists that he is the Christ of darkness. Many of the questions surrounding Lord Avery II's death have never been answered. Avery's family still cannot understand how he landed in prison in the first place. His friend Doran Reed said, "No one could put their finger on it. People that knew Lloyd were like, how did Lloyd turn into a gangster?" His brother Chase says that he's kept some of Lloyd's belongings in his garage, such as his BMX bike that he was riding the morning of his arrest, as well as the Bible he studied in prison. He says it was his brother who brought him closer to God, closer to believing in Jesus. He remembers his brother fondly and even named his youngest son Lloyd, saying that he looks just like him and it's a good name. He didn't want it to get lost, said he wanted to hand it down. And in the years since his brother's murder, Avery has become a hood legend, and the story of his life and death have become something akin to movie lore. The question of how Lloyd Avery turned into a gangster has never been adequately answered. Che Avery likens his brother's descent into gang life to that of Tupac Shakur. He says, "I like to call it the Tupac syndrome." He says Lloyd felt like he had something to prove when he really didn't. Even if you have money and fame, you will sacrifice all of that just to have respect from a bunch of thugs. The aspiring actor turned gangbanger had chosen to live a violent life and ended up dying a particularly violent death. The irony of this story is that Lloyd Avery II spent years battling his demons, trying to escape their grasp. Once he was able to do so, he changed his life and gave it over to God. But then someone else's demons came along and ended his life in the most gruesome of ways. Tune in for the next episode of Queen Amidai TV Presents True Crime.